Thanks for coming, listening to what I'm going to say about calibration of an audiometer. I will start with a presentation of myself. My name is Torben Poulsen, and I have been working at the Technical University of Denmark within these areas where we say psychoacoustics, acoustic communication, hearing loss, hearing aids and things like that. But I have also been involved in international standardization, in the International Standardization Organization, where I've been within threshold of hearing, and this is actually what I'm going to talk about here the next few minutes. I will give you an introduction, and then I will talk about this standard ISO 389, which is a family of standards. There are several parts in it that I will go in a little bit into details in that. Then I will say something about the calibration procedure and come up with an example, and then the final remarks at the end. The aim of calibration. Why do we need to calibrate an audiometer? And this is, of course, to ensure correct measurements of audiograms. Those audiograms are used as the origin for almost everything in audiology. It's the main purpose of an audiogram is to evaluate hearing, whether to find out whether you have a hearing loss or whether you don't have a hearing loss. So that's the main thing of an audiogram. It's also used, the audiogram, as the basis for hearing aid fitting, how to adjust the hearing aid so that it fits the person with the hearing loss. And it also is the background for legal issues, hearing loss compensation. If you have got a hearing loss at the workplace, for example, and you need some compensation for that, then all the legal system will go in and find out whether you are allowed to have such a compensation or not. And for that, the audiogram is used also there. This figure here shows how the hearing threshold runs as a function of frequency. We have frequency on this axis here, and we have sound pressure levels up on the other axis. And the hearing threshold runs like this. It's very high at the low frequency end, up here at 20 hertz, up around 70 decibels. And that means that you need a level of a pure tone of 20 hertz that is at a level of around 70 decibels just in order to be able to hear this. The way this curve is measured is that you have a person sitting in a environment in a room where there are no reflections from the walls and ceiling and floor and so on. There's no background noise. The noise is, or the sound, the pure tone sound is coming frontally into the test person. And the person is listening with both ears, not just one ear, but both ears. That's the way it's measured, that you turn up, for example, such a 100 hertz tone, turning it up until the test subject says, now I can hear this 100 hertz tone. Then you make a cross there, and you do this for all the different frequencies. As I said, it goes up at high levels at low frequencies, but here around 1000 hertz, it's very close to zero decibel, and at 3,000, 4,000 hertz, it's actually below zero, so it's a minus 5 decibels or so here in this frequency range. And that's the resonance of the ear canal that makes us very sensitive in that frequency range. it's also there where the most important speech signals are lying. So there's good reasons for that. Levels in decibels over here. Sound pressure levels. Sound pressure level, dB, SPL, as we used to say in daily life. But we would like to see the deviations from the from this curve in order to find out whether people have a hearing loss or not. So what we do is that we take this green curve and stretch it out and put it on as a zero line in an audiogram. And then the hearing loss is indicated as a curve that goes down. The more hearing loss, the further down you come. So the increasing numbers here for increasing hearing loss, increasing numbers here upwards for sound pressure level. That's the audiogram. And the levels here are in decibels too, but now it's HL, hearing level, as I have shown up there. And an audiogram shows deviations from normal hearing. This family of standards I'll say a little bit about. The acoustics, that's the title of that standard. Acoustics, reference zero for the calibration of audiometric equipment. That's the main headline, the main title of these standards. And then for part number one, the title is Reference Equivalent Threshold Sound Pressure Levels for Pure Tones and Supraaural Earphones. It's a fairly long, complicated title, but with all the correct words and so on. But the meaning is just that for such a supraaural earphone, an earphone that is sitting on top of the pinna, the meaning is just to give you how much level you need to measure in your ear simulator in order to calibrate correctly. There's also a part two of the standard with the same main title, but in this part two, it's the same title over there. The only difference is that now it's insert earphones, not supraaural earphones, but insert earphones. And there are many others coming down here. And the final one, part eight, is something about circumaural earphones. Circumaural earphones that cover the pinna and goes outside the pinna, the outer ear. Here we have the family of these standards. Number one was the supraaural earphones numbers. Part two was from the insert earphones, those that are going into the ear canal. Part three is the vibratory force, which is for bone conduction, calibration of the bone vibrator, the bone conduction thing. Part four is about narrow band masking noise. Those masking noises that you have in an audiometer to make contralateral masking, opposite ear masking of the opposite ear. Part five is for high frequencies, 8 kilohertz up to 16 kilohertz. Part six is for test signals of short duration. Short duration are those small clicks and tone pulses that you're using for EEG measurements and things like that. Part seven is a combination or a connection. It's called the connection between free field and diffuse fields. And part eight is the one with the circumaural earphones. And then part nine, I've given another color here because this does not contain any sound pressure levels. It's just some conditions that you should use if you are going to do measurements of these reference values. If you want to measure such reference values in a lab, laboratory, then you need to follow those recommended conditions. The calibration procedure is like this. And I just remind you that we want to have the connection between the sound pressure levels from this figure into the hearing level in that figure in the audiogram. And step by step, we are doing like this. We put the earphone at the ear simulator. You can see some examples of ear simulators over there. And then we set the audiometer at 0 dB HL, put the audiometer down to 0 dB HL, in principle at least. And then we will measure the sound pressure level in the ear simulator. And that's the sound pressure level, that's SPL. And then we will adjust the audiometer to produce the sound pressure level that is specified in that ISO 389 that we are using, depending on which earphone we are talking about. But we will adjust the audiometer to produce that level that is specified in the ISO standard. Then we will repeat that for the other frequencies, and we will also repeat it for the other earphone, all this procedure. It's fairly simple, step by step, to do these things, and it takes some time, but that's the way it's done. I will give you an example of this. Here we have the frequencies from 125 Hz up to 8 kHz, the typical frequencies, the audiometric frequencies in an audiometer. And in this case, I'm going to calibrate an audiometer to fit a circumall earphone 389-8. And the numbers in the standard are these ones. But if you're going to measure a sound pressure level of 5.5 or 4.5 or 2.5, you will know that this is impossible to measure with traditional measurement instruments. It's much too low, it will disappear, the sound level here will disappear in the internal noise in the sound level meter that you are using. So what you are doing is that you are putting the audiometer at 70 dB instead of just 0 dB, but you increase the whole level by 70 dB. And then there may be some microphone correction, and the final result, the target value for these things, will then be that you take the 70.5 plus the 70 plus 0.9 in this case, and that gives you 88.4. So these are the values that you are going to measure in the ear simulator. And we did that in a certain situation, and we got these results like that. And then we can calculate how much the result deviate from what we wanted it to be. And these deviations are fairly small, only a fraction of a dB. And we will do it also for the right earphone and calculate the deviations. The reason why you sometimes are not able to reach exactly that number there is because the audiometer typically can be adjusted in steps of maybe half a dB or maybe even 1 dB. So you need to find the position where you are closest to come most close to this target value. If you then look at these target values, then you will see that there's one up here, which is 100 dB, 100.5, and 72.6 down there. And this is the biggest one, this is the lowest one. And if you remember the the curve for the hearing threshold in sound pressure level, then you will see that maybe remember that at the low frequencies of 125 hertz, you have this level, which is fairly high, but at 3 kilohertz, 3000 hertz, it's the low value, that's where the curve went down below zero in that situation. But this may be sometimes a little bit complicated to cover such a big range between 100 and 72 in the measurement instrument. So very often an audiometer is adjusted so that instead of putting just 70 as I had in the previous example, that instrument will, when it's brought into calibration mode, then it will adjust its levels automatically from 50 up to 80 or 85 in order to get some target values over there that where the values are within a shorter or more narrow dynamic range. And then again we can measure the level of the left earphone, and we can measure the level of the right earphone and say, okay, this is how it ended up with some deviations here from what we wanted it to be. So, some final remarks about this calibration. I will just mention that the uncertainty in audiometry, in pure tone audiometry, it's said in this another standard, 8253-1, that when you measure with the ascending method, which is the method that you should use out in the clinic and is used out in the clinic, then you end up with an uncertainty on such measurements that are plus minus 5 dB, which means that when you have measured an audiogram, you will have a curve of the hearing loss, and then each of the points on that audiogram can easily go 5 dB up or 5 dB down. If you try to repeat that just 5 minutes later and start a new measurement, then there will be some variation, and that could easily be plus minus 5 dB. And that uncertainty is caused by the hearing threshold determination itself, the procedure there, the equipment, the calibration issue, the transducer and its fitting, how well it's fitted to fit the ear, and noise and the environment around the measurement situation. But uncertainty is mainly related to the psychoacoustic procedure. So these plus minus 5 is mainly caused by the psychoacoustic procedure. But calibration is still important, even though the small deviations that we saw are much smaller than the plus minus 5 dB. The calibration is still important in order to ensure that you are doing correct measurements. Thank you.